Every company is managing information, and today, the protection of confidentiality, integrity, availability, and traceability of the information is a question of business survival. Considering these aspects, ICT Luxembourg proposed to the government to elaborate some guidelines on the CISO function. And this work has been done in the frame of CLUSIL, and today it's a real pleasure to welcome different CISO of the Luxembourgish place to discuss on the CISO function. So first, the CISO is the Chief Information Security Officer. We all know the CIO, the Chief Information Officer. We all know the DPO, the Data Protection Officer. So my question, Myriam, is who is a CISO?
Thank you, Cédric. So for my opinion, a CISO has a central role, a central position to ensure to collaborate with different functions like CIO, risk manager, DPO, service manager, project manager also. And the purpose of this position is to act as an orchestrator to ensure that security topics are involved and follow in this different kind of area. So the CISO has a central position, and he must lead and discussion and collaborate to all these different functions. So it means that he must be able to speak different language, IT and non-IT as well. And the purpose of being a central position is to ensure that the business is running in a secure way. And all these topics, because basically CISO, to ensure the security, cannot act alone. So he need to collaborate as in is complementary with a different function. And to ensure this this proper adequation of security, he must, and indeed it's very important, to have the CISO as a support of the CAO. To ensure to do properly his function. So he needs the support, and he need also to report the security issue as well. So for it's my opinion, like is described in the scheme. I don't know if you see very well, but yes, it's my part.
Yes, I tend to go on your way. Indeed, there are very central keywords that you pronounce, like business. And indeed, the primary goal of security is to protect the business, and security requirements are very often driven by business. In a company, whatever the type of organization is, you have several businesses with several subject matter experts who, of course, we can consider them are kind of responsible of their security as well, but they need the support of somebody which is central, with a team which can drive them into the complexity of what can be the security challenges. We all probably viewed already this type of schema showing security as something transversal. When you describe an information and an IT system and an IT services. And indeed, we already all heard about security in depth, meaning that security is at any layer of what constitutes an IT service. Each business owner knows very well his job, actually, and what he needs to deliver. But the security is something which is totally transversal and can bring challenges that people cannot focus on. And that's why we need to have somebody specialist and expert in the different challenges exposed nowadays.
Yeah, so I would add to that yes, of course, the CISO brings its own expertise in terms of security, but I will also say that we can consider the CISO as the security translator here. You have Google Translate, for instance, and you have Security Translate, which is the CISO. Why? Because in the business currently, everybody knows a little bit about security, everybody has heard about security, but nobody talks security the same way. You will not talk about security to the IT people the same way as you will talk to the board members, as you will talk to the legal department. So the CISO should here not only bring his own expertise and advice and etc., but also be able to translate the expectations of one of the business line into a language that can be understood by the others. And I think for that, yes, the slide displaying the fact that the CISO is central here for everything that is security related is self-explaining the needs here to have this central position and to be able to be the right interface between all the stakeholders.
Okay, on top of the central position, I think the CISO is also someone who can align different strategies, being the business strategy of the company, the security strategy of the company, the risk management strategy of the company. And this position will have to lead to a situation where all these strings can be put together and give one direction and not have a situation where every business line tends in another direction or IT tends in another direction than the business. So you really have to federate all these different trends and put all the strings together in order to have a common approach to new business opportunities or risks or cyber threats. So you have to really put into the equation every business or stakeholder's view in order to get one approach and not have a lot of different strategies that will not lead anywhere.
So it means a CISO is mandatory for every company? Or it will be optional for some of them?
Well, I think nowadays, given the exposure that every company has on being on the internet or when you face internal threats, protection of your vital data, I think you cannot go without the CISO function. Whether you call it CISO or something else, I think you have to have someone who will federate all the different energies that you have in your companies in order to have one approach that takes into account cybersecurity.
Anyway, nowadays, we see the trends and information is actually the heart of many business, and information is more and more digitalized. So it brings challenges that we see happening more and more, even in the news for the last 20 years. So at some point, you have difficulty to imagine a business which doesn't have to face to these challenges, to be honest.
Yeah. Yes, if we say that a CIO is mandatory for basically all companies, because informatics supports the business. But like we said, the business must be performed in a secure way. So for sure, we need to have a security perspective, and security must be taken into account to running your business in a good way. So now, to answer to your question, it depends of the also the size of the company. For sure, the security aspect must be handled, but it depends of the size, because not all company can hire or have the need to hire CISO full-time. So you have to take into account the context of the company, the business, the volume, and the type of data.
Okay, so outsourcing the CISO function can be an option for some companies due to the limitation of size. But another question is also in relation with the outsourcing, or how to say, is to close the skill gap, in fact, because every company needs a CISO, and we are currently facing missing some skills on the market. So is there any specific trainings, any specific formation to be followed by CISO to be able to manage the security efficiently? Or everyone can be, okay, I'm a CISO, he can enter into a company and say, okay, I'm a CISO, trust me. Is there something to ensure the security of the function will be ensured?
At some point anyway, whatever the the activity here is in the company, you need, even if you outsource most of the services that you want to consume or deliver, at some point, at least you need to be able to challenge your vendors. And regarding the service that you deliver yourself, I don't think that anybody can state and stand up as a CISO. In my opinion, when you look at the slide and the schema, you see that it implies that the CISO must be experienced enough in the IT areas to be able to understand also the business of all the people that we see on the drawing here. So he needs to understand what is project management, service delivery, what is the challenges facing to deliver IT services, to do at an infrastructure level, at the software development level sometimes. It depends on the activity, of course. You need to understand the regulations. So the background from a pure scholarship viewpoint, in my opinion, should be at least to have a minimum of a bachelor degree with several years of experience in the domains which are shown on the drawing, actually. And after, indeed, all his life long, he needs also to continue to train himself and to grab knowledge constantly, because things are moving constantly. So, and you have several organizations around the world proposing certifications, proposing trainings. It is not something that you can, you cannot be graduated kind of CISO and then you are good to go for the next 20 years, basically.
Yeah, just to come back to the previous question in order to make a bridge to this one. Every company needs to have, a security guy here, which not always means this needs to be a CISO. You need to have security for the IT, for instance. And as mentioned by Miriam previously, that would also depend on the size and maturity of the company, whether we do need a CISO or not, then being internal or external. One of the things that has been mentioned here is the background of a CISO, the training that has been followed, etc. For me, yes, currently, if you have a look at what kind of profile we have for CISOs, most of them are coming from the IT area. Does that mean that everybody needs to have those skills from scratch? I don't think so, because a CISO is much more than that. You have the communication skills, you have the relationship with the management, you have all those experience here that are also very important. So if you think that you can learn those IT things during your life and not at school, then you can also fit for a CISO position there. And then I do agree also on the fact that it's a never-ending story. Every day we are learning new things. Every day we are trying new things. Every day we are failing also in some areas, because failing is also learning. And this is something that I would say the most important for me is not the background, the trainings, the certifications, but the soft skills. Are you willing to learn? Are you willing to communicate with people, to share information, to anticipate? Are you able to do all those things? If yes, then most of the criteria are matched.
I totally agree with you, but I think we have also, on top of all that has been said, the academic background and all the soft skills, I think you also have to know your company, because you have to align your strategy with the company strategy. So the better you know your company, the more you are able to make the right decisions and to reduce the costs for certain choices, because you know the processes that are going to be implemented, on why this will be implemented, and how all this process will actually work in your company. So I think you have to take into account all these different factors. The technical background is one part, the most visible part, but I think soft skills, the communication skills, are key to sell your ideas, to sell your position, and also to have the arguments to sell your position, you need to know the company. So that's really a key factor in your success as a CISO.
So to play the devil's advocate here, we could say then if you have to know the company, then the size of position cannot be outsourced, which is something then I think we all have something to say about that. But here I think that the fact that we can outsource the DPO function, as long as you have internally someone that can manage privacy, that can talk about privacy and that knows the business, we need the same thing for the size of position, meaning that if you want to consider outsourcing the position, which is always possible here, you need to have a strong relay within the company, within the business, in order to be the interface that will be as much efficient as possible.
I was about indeed to react to the fact that you need to know the company. On the other hand, I like the idea of CISO as a service somehow and outsource it for small business, for example. I think it's possible still. It's just that the job of a CISO as a service starts with assessing and identifying the business services. It's still possible. It's true that it's key, but it doesn't contradict the idea of outsourcing the CISO, in my opinion.
It's clearly possible. It's much easier if you know the company than without, but it's clear that you have to rely on more people if you don't know exactly how your company works, compared to the situation where you have someone with a background with an experience of over 10 years, 15 years into the company. So I think it's easier in that constellation, but CISO as a service is still possible. It's not the easiest way, but for some companies it's the only way, so you have to rely on this situation.
Yes, it depends on the case, but just to join your position regarding the IT skills and also the fact that it's better to know very well the company. I have a concrete example in mind, because in mind of people, they said, okay, a CISO need IT skills. And for sure, we saw that the majority of CISOs that we met have IT background, and to be honest, it's very helpful. But I would like also to assure people that who have not IT skills, they can be also CISO. A good example I have in mind, I have in fact two examples. The first one was a guy working in a hospital who has, during his career, a lot of position. Nurse, work designator, lot of positions, but not IT at all. And at the end of his career, he was a CISO, and he knew very well the company. And honestly, when I discussed with him, when I worked with him, he was very pragmatic and very efficient in the way that he addressed security matters and security issue position. And the second example I have in mind, I discussed last year with a young woman who wants to work in information security. And she told me, it's very interesting, I want a career in that way, in this field, but I don't have IT background. And for her, it was like a break. Yes, it was a constraint. And like we said, a CISO must have different role, different overview, different skills, not only IT, even if it's very helpful, but regarding IT background, IT skills, there are different kind of way of IT skills. It's important to understand the IT, how it works and so on, but it's not mean necessary that you need to be, I don't know, a senior system administrator. So when we say the IT skill, if you understand and if you have are open-minded, like you said, continuous improvement, for me, it's okay. So if you don't have an IT background, it's okay, you can be CISO because we need a CISO. It's an increased position.
Let's say what we need is general IT background, yeah. Not specialist. Yeah, okay. I think here maybe one or two of us can read programming code or can go to a system and make some changes there, but it's the kind of things that we might have had to do in the past, let's say 20, 15 years ago. But nowadays, this is not what a CISO is doing. So yeah, generic IT background in order to understand what the IT is talking about. Yes, deep knowledge is nice to have, indeed, but is not mandatory.
Totally.
Yes, but I would say on the other hand that in everyday life of a CISO, you are supposed also to be able to challenge the different IT providers that can be your colleagues in your company developing software or providing infrastructure. At some point, it doesn't mean that the CISO himself, as a human being, needs to be an expert at all, but at least he needs to have the means. And he could also, you can also view the CISO as somebody organizing a project with experts that he would hire for the time being of running, for example, a penetration testing exercise. So at least if the CISO himself doesn't need to be an expert, at least he needs to have a minimum understanding of what is this world so that he could manage a team to be the counterpart of the team delivering the product or the service. Actually, it's like if you do a parallel in whatever you deliver, somebody is building what you want to deliver, and you have, for example, quality and assurance department, basically people testing. And most of the time, the best practice is that the one delivering is not the one testing, and here it's kind of the same.
Okay, thank you. It was a question, a live question during the talk about is the CISO have more legal rather than IT background? So we already have some evidences for the answer. And may I ask you your background, Miriam?
Yes, I have an IT background, yes. IT diploma and IT background. Also.
Okay.
Yes.
Laurent?
At school, I am graduated from an engineering school in the field of microelectronics originally. And after I moved in my career, I moved slowly to software development to be after that focusing on providing security to IT services.
Okay, Arnaud.
IT background also, was at school with IT IT diploma, and yes, that's the case for most of us, I guess.
Guess what? IT background as well. So I started as a network engineer within the security department, so classical setup.
Okay, thank you.
This question is interesting in the fact that I do remember a discussion that I've had, let's say, 2 years ago with someone from the CNPD that was about the DPO role and whether CISO can also be DPO or not. And the view here at that time was the DPO should have a much more legal background than IT background, even though all the technological and organizational measures that have to be put in place for the GDPR are really hardly IT related, I would say, or at least security there. But yes, the conclusion here was for a DPO, probably the legal background would be better. That would mean that we would have in the balance the fact that for a CISO, maybe it's easier to come from the IT, but again, this doesn't mean that everybody has to come from the IT. Like for a DPO, it doesn't mean that someone coming from the IT will never be a good DPO, because it's not only being a DPO or being a CISO, but being a good one.
Thank you, and time is running. I have two more questions. Arnaud, you stole my words, because I would like, based on the question, I want to discuss on the accumulation of function between the CISO and the DPO. And Lars, for instance, do you see any limitation of the accumulation of function within a company for a CISO. Is a CISO can also lead the operations?
Well, of course, you can combine the CISO function with other functions, but you have to keep in mind that depending on the size of your company, it's a full-time job or even more than a full-time job. So if you have some other task to get done on top of your CISO function, it will be very hard and challenging. On the other hand, you also have to stay independent of production operational tasks. You can combine, but I think it's even easier if you stay independent. So I think in theory you can combine, and in some companies it is done in that way, but I can only advise to have it as a separate function, independent function, because it makes your life easier or less difficult, if you can say.
If the question has to do with I am a small company, I don't have the possibility to hire a CISO full-time, if it is about this sort of question, yes, I think you can combine. It definitely depends on the workload, and the challenge will be to estimate properly the workload of the CISO function, I would say. And after, indeed, there might be some issues, like it would be nice if you are not in charge of securing your own service that you already deliver, because then you cannot have the segregation to, as I made the parallel, let's say, the developer and the tester. But okay. Yes, you can. You can have a role of CISO that you would put on the shoulder of somebody else in your organization. The challenge is to estimate the workload.
Okay, estimation of the workload and segregation of duties. CSSF recently issued a new circular about the line of defense and IT risk. Is the CISO can be cumulated with, in your perspective, the segregation of duties is clearly indicated, for instance? Is it clear for every company?
Regarding the CSSF circular, this is something that I don't have to work with because I'm not in the financial sector here. But something that is important is that the CISO role should not be a tick-the-box activity. So basically here, when you say, can a CISO do other functions, I would say, even though it could be difficult, it can be possible as long as we are still talking about a CISO. I mean, we are here to promote the function, and we don't need to have someone within the company that is officially appointed as CISO, because there is a need to have a CISO in the company and don't have the right skills, don't have the right resources to do the job. So for me, here the most important part is not whether this is cumulated or not with another function, is what are the resources, what are the skills that you have available to perform this task. Can be that someone is a top manager who is also willing to ensure this security responsibility, but has some dedicated team working for him in this area, then for me there is absolutely no reason to not organize the company like that. If this is just someone that is appointed because there is a need to have a CISO, and on the paper he is CISO, let's say he's a paper CISO, that would not mean that much. And here, it's even much more risky because you might give the false impression that security is managed within this company while it's not the case.
Yes, I join him totally because the cumul of function of responsibility could be a wrong answer. And because you have to take into account, like you said, the time, the skills, the resource, and we've seen that, yes, and it's also the global trend to add more and more tasks to people. And if you have had the task of a CISO to someone which don't have the security mindset, yes, what we've done, what we'll be to do, it's it's not his priority, so he'll be perform security on the side when he has time, so it's not a good solution. So for me, if the company don't have the resource, the possibility to hire a CISO, it's better to have a CISO, to take the CISO as a service to ensure that this function is addressed properly.
Okay, so now the question is for companies that do not have extensive knowledge on security, how to advise them or to force them to have a CISO? Is there some good incentive to expect from the government, to expect from the legal corpus, for defining what will be the pre-required size for being a CISO, what will be the right organization for a CISO? Mm-hmm. Is there something the market can expect?
I think as all the companies live together in some system, and the security of one company can easily affect the security of another company, I think it's vital to have a common approach to this threat and cybersecurity field. I think you cannot expect for some companies to deploy energy and resources in securing their business, while on the other hand, other companies can go freestyle and potentially affect the whole internet in the country or even at a larger scale, just because they would try to do some economies on the CISO function or the security, IT security as a whole. So I think you have to have a common approach, and the approach should be unified over the sectors and in every company.
Indeed, companies are more and more connected together. Information is digitalized to enable the business. You need to have a relationship between systems. Actually, it's like the human beings. When you are infected by the COVID, then you can infect your neighbor. And since system, when you do business, are interconnected together, as you said, it's not only a problematic of your own company to have a CISO or not, or to take security into account or not. Your appetite to security and to evaluate your security posture can also impact your partners, your customers, impact your partners and your customers and your own business, of course.
For my position, yes, like you, it's the regulation is a good approach, is a good solution to provide weight to the function, to enforce the role of the CISO. So if I make a parallel with GDPR and the DPO role, a DPO, since the GDPR so exists, the role of DPO exists since 2 years. And now people have the reflex when they start a project to say, do we have to make a PA? But they don't have the reflex to say, do we have to make a risk analysis? Because and also in the GDPR, the scope of the DPO is very clear. It's personal data protection. Regarding the CISO, so the function exists since more than 20 years, maybe more, yeah? And we are still searching. That's why also we are here. And it's not clear in the mind of people, of collaborators. And our scope is basically information security. And like we saw in the slide, we cover different security matters, which are operational, compliance, BCP, GRP, and so on. And these security topics are in other also taking into account for other collaborators. So there is an ambiguous way. So just to give a concrete example, for example, patching. Is it more a security concern or is it more an IT concern or both? And sometimes it's both. But at the time when you have two people making a task, at the end nobody do it. And we see on internet that we have some vulnerabilities from months, still not patches and still exploited. But why? Because it's not clearly mandatory, so it's not a priority, so it's not addressed. So here's the fact. So we have, at the end, basic security concern like patching and other, which are not properly addressed because there is no obligation. And for me, the regulation can be a good answer to that.
Yes, indeed. Just relying on the goodwill is not something that will help to ensure that we increase the maturity, the security maturity level of companies. You need to have a constraint here. The GDPR here has brought such constraints for privacy. We most probably need to have the same for security. So whether a law should mention the role of a security officer, IT security, CISO, whatever would be its name. Yes, I do think that if we really want to achieve the fact that security is high on the agenda of each company, and therefore Luxembourg can promote on the international scene the fact that we are a secure country, this should be in the law. But how? This is something that is pretty complex to address because we all have the same title almost, but not exactly the same scope, not exactly the same responsibilities, not exactly the same way to address it. So I think we should not be too ambitious initially because the maturity level about security is very low. And we should try to design a kind of minimum viable product here that would be the basic profile, let's say the initial, not the basic, because it's always complex, but the initial profile of a CISO in a company. And from there, we can already start implementing this minimum requirements to companies, whether internally out or externally with outsourcing, which is always possible. And from there, gaining in maturity and going further into the description of a more complex role as we all have to cope with on a day-to-day basis.
Okay, thank you very much for this conclusion. Thank you, all of you, for your presence. Thank you very much. And I think there is lots of work to do. And maybe it's us as CISO to define the minimum viable product. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.